My name is Cantor Dan Singer. I'm here at Stephen Wise Free Synagogue on the Upper West Side of New York City. But I'm originally from a small town at the tip of Lake Superior on the Wisconsin side called Superior, Wisconsin. This is a small town that Bob Dylan's family originally immigrated to. It was founded by General John Hammond, the grandfather of the John Hammond who signed Bob Dylan to Columbia Records. Across from Superior is Duluth, where Bob Dylan was born, and he was raised up in Hibbing, this area of the country he calls the North Country. So it's a rare opportunity to meet two Jews from the North Country familiar with Bob Dylan. My dad was a researcher on Bob Dylan's life on a book that came out in 1997. And we all knew Louie Kemp as a prominent member of the Jewish community of Duluth. And he opened his home very warmly to the Jewish community on many occasions and was very generous. And he continues today in California. And so it's an honor to bring to you a conversation with Louie Kemp that explores Bob Dylan's Jewish identity through his book, Dylan and Me, 50 Years of Adventures. We barely scraped the surface of what we could have talked about, but you'll have to get the book to learn more. Please enjoy this conversation from the North Country. Louie Kemp, it's an honor to have you here at Stephen Wise Free Synagogue. Welcome.
Thank you.
We go back a long way. I hail from the North Woods of Wisconsin, the North Country, what Bob Dylan calls the North Country. I'm from Superior. I was raised in Superior and went to college in Superior. And I grew up knowing about Louie through my parents. Louie was a local legend, and it's just such an honor to have you here today. We grew up knowing you from Kemp's Fisheries and your wild success, business success of expanding it from a family-owned business, a local thing, into an international empire. And we also knew you from your lifelong friendship with Bob Dylan, which came from that North Country, part of Wisconsin and Minnesota. You were born in Duluth, as was Bob. And I would love to tell you, I'd love for you to tell us about what it's like to be from the North Country.
Well, northern Minnesota is distinctly different than the southern part of the state, the Twin Cities. It's a blue-collar type of life up there. The people are hardworking, good, solid, God-fearing people. And it was a good place to grow up. I met Bobby, even though we were both born in Duluth at St. Mary's Hospital. I met Bobby at Herzl Camp in northern Wisconsin, which was a Zionist Jewish camp, and we both went there for 5 years, and it had a big influence on us.
So my brother and sister attended also Herzl Camp. I was kind of deprived. So I read your book feeling jealous of the friendships that you you developed between Larry Keegan and Bob Dylan and all the adventures.
Bobby Zimmerman,
that's right. I don't know how we should refer to him in this interview. Should we call him Bobby?
You call him Bobby. That's who he is to me, Bobby.
All right. So good. So it's nice to be a part of this gang of rascals that were kind of rabble-rousers. So Bob was born in Duluth, but he was raised in Hibbing. I recently went up to visit there. Have you been up there?
Not recently, no.
But he came a lot to Duluth, you mentioned in
yes,
your
because,
book.
You know, Hibbing was a city of about 16,000. It was a mining town in the heart of the Mesabi Iron Range. Duluth was a town of 100,000, so there was a lot more action in Duluth. So after we met at camp, he would come down and stay at the my house in Duluth, and we would, there's a lot more to do,
Yeah.
And then if we got bored in Duluth, we'd grab the train and go down to the Twin Cities, where we had a lot of friends who we met at Herzl.
Including Larry Keegan, and who's in the Twin Cities.
Especially Larry Keegan.
Yeah.
He was our very close friend.
Yeah, so could you share a story from Camp Herzl? Just a little story from there, because you have so many great stories in your book, just one little vignette, maybe.
Okay, I'll tell you one story. One night, we were saying, we should, the guys in the cabin next to us, they're such goody-goodies, they always do the right thing. Let's give them a little surprise tonight. So we took cans of shaving cream. After it was lights out, Lila Tove, and everybody was sleeping, and we went over to their cabin, and it was all bunk beds, and we went up and down the aisles, and we put shaving cream on all their faces, and we thought that was hilarious.
You described Bobby as a Van Gogh with Barbasol.
Oh yeah, he was having fun. And we were laughing and thinking we were really cool, And then after we got everybody shaving creamed up, we ran back to our cabin next door and, took our clothes off and pretended we were sleeping. And after not too long, we started to hear shrieks and screams coming from that cabin, because what happens is once they open their eyes, they get the shaving cream in their eyes and it burns, and they get it in their mouth and they start coughing, and they were screaming and yelling, and the counselors came running and saw what happened, and then they brainstormed and said, who would do such a thing? Oh, it has to be those guys. It has to be Bobby, Louie, and Larry. Nobody else would have the chutzpah to do that. And so they came into our cabin. They pulled the covers off us. They said, we know you guys did it, get up. And of course we pretended we didn't, but there was nobody else. There was no other choices, So they said, okay, you guys are gonna get your punishment now. So they took us and they said, okay, we're gonna march you guys through the woods. And they took their car and they had us go in front of the car, and and it was cold and it was dark, and the mosquitoes were all over the place. Mosquitoes are like this, After a while we came to a camp area where there was logs on each side of a fire area. So they said, okay, we'll give you guys a break for a few minutes. So they lit a fire and they sat on one side of the fire, we sat on the other side, and we were talking, and I said, this is for the birds. I'm not going to do this anymore. And they both said, I'm not going to do this anymore either. So I said, let's just take off. These guys aren't going to be able to catch us. So we take off, and we start going running down the road. And we come to their car. They had parked it on this road. Right. And as I was going by the car, I looked in, and the keys were in the car. I said, well, keys in the car, that's a gift. So I said,
and how old were you?
So maybe at that point, 14, 15. But you could get driver's license in Minnesota at 15.
Okay.
I knew how to drive at 13. So we jumped in. Bobby got in the shotgun. Larry got in the back seat. I turned the ignition, I hit the gas and we took off, and the counselors were screaming, come back, come back. Looked in the rearview mirror. These guys were freaking out. So, and long story short, we go for a joyride. We actually go off the campgrounds, go onto the county highway.
This is near Hinckley, right?
No. This is northern Wisconsin, near Webster, Wisconsin.
Webster, Wisconsin, yeah.
And, we were thinking pretty damn cool. And then we realized we just stole the car and we're not on the campgrounds anymore. This is like a felony or something. We better go
back. Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah, Grand Theft Auto, that's what it was. And we said, we better go back. So zip a U-turn and go back. We ditched the car, in the woods. And then we hide in the woods until everybody leaves the cabins. Then we go back to our cabin. And, we were so tired and hungry and everything, we fall asleep. They find us there, a couple hours later, they take us to the head rabbi, Rabbi Zvi Dershowitz, who's a really good
Dershowitz?
Dershowitz, yeah, okay. Really a good guy. And he says, never in the history of Herzl have we had anybody do anything like this. He said, you guys have to be punished. He was going on and on. And then finally he said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you guys a break. If you agree to be perfect campers from now on, I won't expel you like I should. And I won't tell your parents, but you gotta agree that you don't tell anybody either. You know, he didn't want anybody to know, you know, that we did this because, you know, it shows, you know, they lost control, you know. So anyway, we agreed and we stayed and we came back for a few more years and it had a big influence on us.
That's great. It's nice to have second chances or even third chances, however it might have been. That's really cool. So can you tell us a little bit more about the book? Generally, what is it about and why did you write it?
Yeah, it covers 50 years of our friendship together, our adventures together, and starting at 11 years old at camp and going forward. I never had any intention ever to write a book, but I would tell these stories sometimes at Shabbat dinners I have at my house or somebody else's house. Everybody knew, or a lot of people knew I was friendly with Bob. So I tell a story here, a story there. People would always be on my case to, you got to write a book. You know, these stories are good.
Yeah.
And a very close friend of mine, Svi Small, who was a producer of the Grammys for 21 years, he moved to Israel at some point, and whenever he'd come to L.A. to do the Grammys or America's Got Talent, which he was also a producer of after that, he'd stay at my house like for 3 months at a time, and we'd swap stories. He had great stories too.
I imagine.
And he would always say, "Oh, Lou, you gotta write a book. These stories are amazing. You gotta share them with people." I said, "Yeah, one day." So unfortunately, Svi comes down with stage 4 lung cancer. And I would go visit him all the time in Malibu. And one day, I walked in, and he wasn't doing good. And he had an oxygen. And I said, "How are you doing?" He said, "I'm not." He says, "I feel like hell." I said, "Well, I brought you some of your favorite deli stuff." I'd always bring him his favorite deli stuff from the city. And he said, "Okay, good. Put it down." He says, "So when are you going to write your book?" I said, "Write a book? I've thought about that." He says, "No, you got to write that book." He says, "I insist that you write it." So he wouldn't let me alone. And finally, he said, "You have to promise me you're going to write the book." Oh. Now, here's my friend. He's obviously dying, and this is all he wants to talk about. So I said, "Okay, if you want me to, I'll write it." He said, "Good. When are you going to write it?" I said, "Well, I don't know." He says, "Do you know anybody that's written a book?" No, I said, "I don't know anybody that's written a book. I don't know." I said, "I've never written a book. I don't know how to write a book." He said, "Do you know anybody that's written a book?" I said, "Well, my friend Kinky Friedman's written books." He said, "Okay, call Kinky and have him explain to you how to do it." I said, "Okay." He said, "No, call him right now." I said, "Right now?" He said, "Yeah, right now, in front of me. I want to see it." So I took out my phone. I called Kinky. I said, "Kinky, I'm thinking about writing a book." He says, "Great idea," because Kinky, you know, knew the stories too. And I said, "Well, what do I do?" So he explained to me what to do. And he actually hooked me up with his agent. And I subsequently met with them, and they were excited about it and encouraged me to do it and all this and that. And that's how it happened.
That's amazing. I've never heard that before. That's really cool. And Kinky actually wrote the foreword to your book.
Yes.
And it begins with a question. It sounds a lot like what we ask on Passover. How is this book different from all other books? And you end with a blessing that's like the Yivarechecha and the priestly blessing.
I end the book with a blessing to Larry and Bobby.
To Larry and Bobby, and and I think it resounds very much as, to me, it resonates as a very Jewish book. Can you talk more about that?
Well, it definitely has a strong Jewish theme to it, because first of all, we're all of us are Jewish, you know, Bobby, Larry, and I, and we had a strong Jewish influence from our families. We all grew up. Bobby and I grew up in conservative houses. I think Larry was in a reform, but you know, our Jewishness was very much a part of who we were. And then we end up having a lot of Jewish experiences, you know, going forward. And I think in the case of Bobby, you know, having grew up, you know, in a Jewish house, of course, he had a bar mitzvah, like we all did. He, those values that were distilled in him, those Jewish values, had a lot to do with him being a champion for underdogs and fairness in life.
That's beautiful. How did you meet Kinky? That's an interesting.
Yeah, so Kinky Freeman and the Texas Jew Boys. That was the name of his band.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's got some pretty funny songs.
He's got some real interesting satire songs.
I think there's a point where Bobby actually sings one of his songs in your book.
I think so. Yes.
Yeah. Ride 'em Jew Boy.
Yes. And, but my favorite song of his is called "They Ain't Making Jews Like Jesus Anymore." you got to listen to it. It's a satire. It's very funny and very cool. So, you know, Kinky's written many mystery novels also. He's a real character. Mm-hmm. But when I was producing the Rolling Thunder Review tours for Bobby, Kinky came to some of the first concerts, and then later we had him as a performer on the second tour.
That's really cool. What's interesting is you're from Duluth, but Bobby was raised in Hibbing. They're very different towns. The coal mining town versus a big city. I came from Superior, which was a bit more like Hibbing. It's kind of it was considered the uninhabitable part across from Duluth when General Hammond created the town. And did you guys ever venture over into Superior at all, or?
Well, I'd go over to Superior because the bars in Superior in Wisconsin would stay open an hour later than the bars in Duluth. So when the bars in Duluth would close, we'd go over across the bridge to Superior, you know, to keep going.
So just so people know, Superior is also called Soup Town.
Yes.
Because they at least locals, we used to brag that we had the most bars per capita of any town in the country. So yeah, the bars are a big draw for Superior.
Right.
But you know, my dad knew your family growing up as well, and you know, we met you on occasions in Duluth concerts and stuff, and we went to your home sometimes. You had this very big home overlooking Lake Superior in Duluth, where you got married.
Yes.
And you opened your home oftentimes for the whole Jewish community to enjoy. Sukkot and other festive times, and just remember the generosity that you displayed and your kindness, and it's still evident today.
I
think about Superior a lot because my dad was an historian and he was a researcher for one of the first books about Bobby's Jewish upbringing in Minnesota. It's called Just Like Bob Zimmerman's Blues. Dylan in Minnesota. It's by Dave Engel, and he was working on it. Was one of the last things he did before he passed away in 98. It was 90. This was came out in 97, but I remember just how active you were in the Jewish community, and I just wondered if you guys ever talked about his ancestry. You dedicate this to your ancestry and for those to come. And. And I just wondered if he ever thought about his ancestry, because my dad researched his family coming to Superior and founding the Jewish community in Superior, where they're buried, actually. His grandparents and great-grandparents are buried in Superior. So I wondered if you guys ever talked about or explored Superior at all.
You know, he told me that his ancestry was Lithuanian and from Odessa, and you know, the Zimmermans came from Odessa to Duluth around the turn of the century, and they were instrumental in founders of an Orthodox synagogue there. And I remember one time when Bobby came to visit me in Duluth, I said, you want to, let's go over to the Orthodox synagogue that your family was involved in. He said, sure, let's do it. So we went there.
Yeah.
And we went there for Mincha, and there was just a, this was, you know, by that time, it was, even though it was a big synagogue, you know, mm-hmm. the amount of congregants was very small. You know,
it was in the basement, as I recall. My dad took me there, too.
Yes, and we went in, and I knew some of them, and I introduced, I never said who he was, but I said, it's my friend Bobby. A couple of these guys, you know, figured it out. Mm-hmm. He said, oh, I knew your father. I knew your grandfather.
Yeah.
You know, they're great guys, and you know, it was, and we davened. It was a nice experience.
Yeah, in this book, it only covers his background up until he left Minnesota for New York. So it's not like a full biography, but it just covers his time in Minnesota. And I think one of the things people forget about is how people end up, how does a Jew end up in the North Country? You know, at least from that book, I learned about the Cantors and the Shabsi Cantors who founded the Jewish community in Superior, and how they came from Lithuania and founded the synagogue that I prayed in, Agudas Achim, which was the same name as his shul in Hibbing, the one in Hibbing. But his family really coalesced in Duluth after they left Superior, and so it's beautiful that you went there and you prayed together in that place, which I think recently. Tragically, burned down.
Tragically, it burned down a couple years ago. A homeless person apparently accidentally started a fire to keep warm, and it burned down. This is a synagogue that was in constant use since 1902. Beautiful place. Yeah.
And the Torah scrolls from the ones from the shul were saved, but the ones in the basement weren't. I found out. Okay. I talked with Sam Pomish. Oh. They got the ones from upstairs, but the ones in the basement, which were from Agudas Achim on Hammond Avenue in Superior, those ones, after they closed that one down, they demolished one in Superior.
They moved
and they moved. Sam moved those Torahs over to Duluth, to Das Israel, and those were lost, sadly.
That's very sad.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's wild to have grown up there. And I think there was probably more flourishing Jewish community in your generation than in mine. By the time I came there, there were no rabbis in Superior and no rabbis in Hibbing.
No, Duluth had it. You know, when I was growing up, there was about 3,000 Jews in Duluth. Mm-hmm. And the AZA and BBG, Jewish youth movements, were very active.
Right.
And so we had our group of young Jews that hung out together.
And you talked a little bit about your bar mitzvah. You mentioned to me you were trained by a Cantor. You credit Cantor Braverman for training you for your bar mitzvah and for life. Yes. So thank you for crediting the Cantors.
Yeah, well, if you're anything like Cantor Braverman, you're keeping good company, I'll tell you. He was a prince of a gentleman, and I would go to his room. He had a one-room apartment. He was the Cantor at the Orthodox Shul. And and he would teach me like for an hour Hebrew, and I learned Hebrew, and to this day I can read Hebrew, but unfortunately, you know, we were supposed to go back afterwards to learn what it meant. We never went back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but we were able to make a good showing.
Bobby's bar mitzvah was up in Hibbing at the Android Hotel.
Yeah.
He was trained by an Orthodox rabbi. Like you were trained by an Orthodox Cantor, he had an Orthodox rabbi who came under mysterious circumstances and lived above the, a bar that he used to boogie at after lessons.
It was like a sweet shop or something.
Sweet shop?
Yeah, they had a jukebox in there. And,
a jukebox,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And so he would go there. He described it as having come from New York and was there under mysterious circumstances.
Yeah, he said one day this Orthodox rabbi just got off the Greyhound bus, and he trained me for a year, and then my bar mitzvah was over, he just left.
Yeah, I did a little research, and I found out his name was Reuben Mayer Rabinovichi, I think is his name, And it turns out that he was actually from Romania. I think he was originally from Romania, and he may have come in through New York, but he ended up in Minnesota, in Minneapolis. So I thought it was just an interesting training that you both went through. Did you attend one another's B'nai Mitzvah?
Not that I recall.
Bobby, no? But you showed me an announcement of your Bar Mitzvah.
Yes, I have an original announcement that was in Tiferet Israel Synagogue's bulletin, the week of my...
Right. Yeah. It's a nice photo, too. You still got the baby face, too. It's great. I wish there was an announcement somewhere of Bobby's Bar Mitzvah. Mm-hmm. Maybe it'll be unearthed someday. I actually went to visit his old synagogue in Hibbing, which is now a private home. And you can still see there the Magen David on the window in the back and everything. It's just wild. But there's no more Jews left in Hibbing or in Superior.
There's a handful.
Maybe a small handful.
There's a handful, right.
Yeah. You turned later in life to Orthodox practice through your friend, Rabbi Manus Friedman. Can you speak more to your religious journey and your affiliations?
Yeah, so I'll tell you what happened. I was in my 30s by then, and I had become, successful business-wise and in other ways, but I adopted the American blueprint for success, which was make as much money as you can, get all the material possessions you can, and if you're a guy, get as many girls as you can. That was the Western blueprint when I was growing up. And so I did all that, and I was successful. But after a while, I felt this emptiness in me, that there was something was missing. I started questioning that blueprint. I said, I can't believe that's the only reason I was sent to this world, just to for this. So I remember asking my friend Larry Keegan, in St. Paul, I said, I told him how I felt. He says, I get it. He says, I feel that too. I said, if you come across anybody that can answer my questions about the deeper meaning of life, not the superficial meaning, please let me know. Mm-hmm. So about 6 months later, he called me and he said, I met this rabbi in St. Paul, Chabad rabbi, Rabbi Manus Friedman. He said, he's quite amazing, and I heard him speak. He said, I'd like to introduce you to him. I said, okay, good. He said, he's the guy that maybe can answer your questions. I said, okay. So a few months later, I was going to fly from Los Angeles to Duluth to see my mother, but you have to change planes in Minneapolis. At that time, I was living with Bobby in a house in Brentwood. And he was studying the New Testament. He had gotten into the New Testament. So I fly to, so I told Larry I'm gonna be at the Minneapolis airport for an hour if you wanna come out and visit, and he used to do that. So he said, yeah, I'll be there. So I gave him my flight number. This was the days when you could go right up to the plane, no security, none of this stuff. And I get off the plane, and there's Larry in his wheelchair with his Mexican helper. He was a quadriplegic by then, right. Where he had a diving accident.
You have a chapter about that.
Yes, it's in
Larry
the book.
Gets the chair.
I talk about it in the book. Larry gets the chair. And another side of him was obviously, by his dress, an Orthodox rabbi. So I walk over, Larry introduces me to Rabbi Manus Friedman. He says, Ooh, you told me you've got questions about life. He said, this is the guy to ask. Okay. So we go over and we sit down, and the best way I can describe that meeting is, I had good questions, but Rabbi Friedman had great answers. Every one of his answers, blew me away. It was answers I'd never heard before. So I was very much enjoying this, and I just asked him a question. I know I'm writing up a big tab with God for all my good fortune. How can I start making payments to pay him back? And before he could answer me, the loudspeaker called the flight to Duluth. I said, "Oh, Rabbi, that's my flight to Duluth. I got to go." He said, "Well, if you want to study with me, I'm holding session. I'm in session in St. Paul at the Chabad House, a school that's called Beis Hana. If you want to come for a few days, you can sit in on the classes, and then I'll meet with you at night, and I'll answer your questions from that day's learning and this question." I said, "Okay, I'm going to do that." So I visited my mom for a few days, and I came back and went to Beis Hana. Larry and I get to Beis Hana. He had already started for the day. Alfonso and I carry Larry up the stairs. There's these two big imposing doors. We open the doors, and there's Rabbi Friedman facing us with many people in the room with their backs to us. So we quietly go in and sit in the back. And after about 10 minutes, I nudge Larry, and I say, "Larry, it's all women in this class. Everybody here is women." He said, "Oh, I forgot to tell you. He only teaches women. You're the first guy he's ever invited to his class." All right, so my mother didn't make any dummies. Instead of staying 3 days, I stayed 3 weeks, you know? And I learned all day long in the class. And that night, he was kind enough to go one-on-one with me and answer my questions. At the end of the 3 weeks, that night, after that last class, he said to me, "Louie, if you look in the mirror, you may think you look the same. But there's no way that you can be the same person inside that you were 3 weeks ago after what you just learned." Hmm. I said, "You're right, Rabbi." He said, "What are you going to do about it?" "What am I going to do about it? I don't know. I haven't thought about that." He said, "Well, think about it." And then he said, "There's 613 commandments. If you keep these 613, I said, wait a sec, Rabbi, you got to know who you're talking to. I grew up in Duluth, right, with no Jewish education, surrounded by non-Jews. The only reason I know about the Ten Commandments is because of the movie, and I can't keep all of those." So he gave me kind of a look. He sat quiet for what seemed a long time, stroking his beard. And I'm sitting there, you know, kind of uncomfortable, what's going on? Then he says to me, "Louie, there's 5 commandments. If you keep these 5 commandments, your whole relationship with God will change, and you'll start to make major payback on that big tab that you told me you were running up, which you are." So then he told me what the 5 commandments were and explained them on multiple levels. He told me on the face level, on the deeper level, on the mystical level, you know, so I
shot,
could,
remez,
yeah,
drosh,
yeah, all that sword, stuff, yeah, sources and everything. And then he quit talking, you know, he stopped talking. And I pondered what he said to me for about a minute, and then I said to him, "Okay, Rabbi, I'm going to do it." He says, "You're going to do them all?" I said, "Yes." He said, "When do you want to start?" I said, "Right now." Because I knew when you're faced with truth, emes, you've got 2 choices. You could either embrace it or run away from it. It's much easier to run away from it. You know, you don't have to change your whole life, you know, but then you're running, you know, you're not accomplishing anything. And I knew this was emes and truth, so I decided to do it. He said, "Okay, great, come back here 10 o'clock in the morning, and I'll set you up." So I come back there. He gives me a pair of tefillin, shows me how to put them on, gives me a pair of tzitzis, explains all that to me, gives me a sitter, shows me how to daven every day. He gives me all kinds of books, you know, about Shabbos and kashrus and you name it. You know, I walked out of there like this, you know. And that was it. I drove up to Duluth. I told my mother, I said, "Well, you know, Mom, I'm keeping Shabbos now, I'm keeping kosher. I, you know, this and that. She was going to call the police, you know. She thought I fell in some cult or something, you know. But I said, no, Mom, this is it. I said, your father was an Orthodox Jew. I'm sure you could appreciate this. She said, oh, that was then. This is now. I said, now it's the same. You know, the values are the same. So that was it. And then so when I went back to Los Angeles, to the house where Bobby and I were living together,
yeah,
it was an interesting situation. He's in one side of the house studying the New Testament.
Right.
I'm in the other side of the house studying the Torah. And then we would meet in the kitchen in the afternoon where we'd, you know, drink and have some food and talk and tell each other about, what's on our minds. And we'd kind of try to, persuade each other in our point of view. But it became obvious to me shortly that he had been doing this for quite a while, studying the New Testament. I was a newbie, you know, so I didn't have the ammunition to confront all the things he was throwing at me. So after one of those sessions, I called Rabbi Friedman back in Minnesota. I said, Rabbi, I have a Jewish friend who I live with who studies the New Testament, and I don't really have the depth of knowledge, Torah knowledge, to refute the things he throws at me. If I fly you out here, will you come and speak with him? He said, sure. I said, okay, I'll get back to you. So the next day, when we're in the kitchen talking, I said to Bobby, my rabbi's coming out here next week. Would you like to meet with him? He said, sure, bring him to the house. I said, okay. So that after that session, I called Rabbi. I said, okay, I'll get you a ticket for next week. We settled on a date that was good for him. Got him the ticket. I picked him up at the airport. I took him to the house. And Bobby really liked him. And they got along great. And that was the start of the process to bring Bobby back to the religion of his ancestors. And then I introduced him to a lot of other rabbis, introduced him to a lot of cool Orthodox guys that I thought he would like, Meir Rabbi Sarah, a bunch of other guys who he liked, Meir Rhodes. And these were, guys who lived in both worlds.
Yeah.
And it was a process. Then we would start to go to Crown Heights, to the Verbringens of the Lubavitcher Rebbe. And that had a big influence on him, too.
Yeah. Could you describe that in more detail, like just the Verbringens and what you described standing there for many hours.
Yeah.
He's speaking in Yiddish, and you didn't understand a single word, but there was something very holy.
Well, anybody that's been to Crown Heights when the Rebbe was alive, it was an amazing experience. The place would be packed full. I think 3,000 people would have helped. And he would be up, the Rebbe would be up there talking in Yiddish. They call it Verbringing. He'd be teaching, in Yiddish. And even though we didn't understand the words, the meaning and the holiness of it would penetrate us and our souls in the shamas. And we'd stand there for hours enjoying it and getting uplifted from it. I remember on one occasion, Larry was with us. We're in the back, and the Rebbe's for bringing, and he's standing up, and he took his Kiddush cup, and he's staring right into Larry's eyes. I was on one side of Larry, Bobby was on the other side, and he's staring in his eyes, and he lifted up the Kiddush cup, which had wine in it, and said, L'chaim, right to Larry. Everybody could tell it was to Larry. And so Bobby and I said to each other afterwards, geez, the Rebbe really likes Larry. He can tell by looking at somebody's souls who they really are. He's not into the material life. And Bobby said, I think we better work on our souls. I said, yeah, we better. And it was that type of experiences that we had. And then we both had occasions to meet the Rebbe.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a really amazing experience. So how is it that Bob Dylan got into Christianity in the first place.
He had a friend, a lady friend, who was a Christian, a very serious Christian, and she was studying the New Testament every day in Bible classes. And she said to him one day, "You want to come with to one of the classes? You know, you might find it interesting." Well, Bobby's like a sponge. You know, he likes to check everything out. You know, that's who he is. And he said, "I'll come along." You know, so he went, and he found it interesting. You know, it's obvious to me that his neshama was screaming out for spirituality. If I had met Rabbi Freeman before that and taken him to a Torah class, it would have been the other way around, I think. But it chronologically didn't go that way.
Was there like a life change for Bobby at that time? There was some things going on in his life that he was sorting through, or
he had gotten divorced maybe a year before.
Yeah.
And he's the type of person always questioning everything and every aspect of life.
And you talked about Hollywood being full of some people there who are not like, not quite real. You know, there's like not that looking for real relationships. And one of the things that Manas Friedman was talking about is having genuine, real relationships with people. Do you feel like that's something from the North Country also, is just having like, just being real people, being kind of straightforward?
Yeah, we both had good friendships from the North Country, and that wasn't hard to obtain there because the people were very real. Nobody was looking to take advantage of you, or you know, neither of us were, you know, wealthy or famous at the time, so any friendships you formed were legitimate ones. So
right.
By the time you get out to Hollywood, it's a different different situation. And then by the time you become wealthy in my case and famous and wealthy in Bobby's case, you never know what the ulterior motives are of people.
Right. I think I'm recalling when you were here in New York visiting Bobby at his apartment, there were people who were rummaging through his garbage, and it was kind of a feeling of everyone trying to find out more information about him. It must be like on someone's rise to fame. It must be a hard thing for somebody from the North Country to deal with.
Well, in the 60s, you know, he was so prolific in the songs that he wrote that had such a huge effect on the world and society and people. There was people that were going through his garbage trying to figure out what he ate and what he wrote, and if there's any things in there to get more information about him. They called himself Dylanologist. Mm-hmm. And so it was, obviously something that he didn't enjoy.
Yeah, I think my dad wrote a review of this book, and he says, you know, Bob Dylan's already been Dylanized to death. You know, there's too many people obsessing over him. You know, do we really need another book about him? But people are still writing books about him today, and people are still trying to find out more about who he is. And I feel like your book gives us a firsthand account. And that's what Kinky Friedman said is so different about this book from all other books, is that you were there. I love also the way that you described, you actually took a drive together into Crown Heights.
Williamsburg.
In Williamsburg, that's it.
Yeah.
Williamsburg during
He said
days.
To me, when I was in New York visiting him, he said, "I'm going to take you, show you something." And I said, "Okay." So we get into his station wagon. We're in Greenwich Village. He lives on McDougal Street. And he takes me to Williamsburg, you know, the Hasidic section of Williamsburg. And, you know, I'd never seen anything like that. And we're going up and down the streets, and, you know, everything's in Hebrew, and you see all the Hasidim, and, you know, the women pushing, you know, triple strollers with four or five kids following behind them, you know, and the men, and you know, Eastern European garb, you know. And he said, "What do you think of this? This is amazing." And he was, you know, we were both very much moved by it.
That's great. There was an interview with Bob Dylan on 60 Minutes where he mentions to the in the interview that he had made a deal with destiny, that he had made a deal with God or something.
I think he said the boss.
The boss, yeah. Yeah, the boss. Were you ever aware of that, like growing up, or was, because you were there in the armory when he had that kind of moment. He talks about that in his Nobel Prize speech, that moment where his eyes connected at the armory. Just describe to us the armory, your experience there, and if there was any deal that went on with the boss at that time, or?
Yeah, so I remember asking Bobby, I said, "How are you able to write these songs?" I said, "This is quite amazing." He says, "It's not me, it's God." He says, "He puts the words in my head, and I'm just a scribe, and I write them down. He gets all the credit." He was very humble. He has always been very humble about this gift that he was given from God. And he knows that it was a gift. So I think that's what he was referring to in that interview, his understanding of the gift that he was given.
Do you remember it being like a specific time or place where he made the deal with God, or is it that he just reflected upon his life?
I think at some point he came to the understanding that, you know, all blessings come from God, right, and that there's certain responsibilities that come with it, and I'm not sure how he forged the deal. I remember I forged a few deals with God myself, and I said, "I'll do this and this if you do this and this," and that's what happened. I think the similar thing happened with him. But he took that gift, and he very humbly ran with it, and has shared it with the world. I mean, he's out there now doing concerts all through Europe, and has constantly shared this gift in a very humble way.
It's amazing for somebody in his 80s.
He's 81.
Yeah, to have like years in advance such a concert schedule. Yeah. He's just this never-ending tour. Right. And
well, I think he sees it as his responsibility to share this gift and in a humble way, and he's done it, and he's still doing it.
Yeah. Describe the armory, your moment there in high school.
So that was interesting. What happened was, this was January 31st, 1959, in Duluth. Buddy Holly played at the Duluth National Guard Armory. Now, Buddy Holly was one of the pioneers of rock and roll, and he had a big influence on a lot of young people at that time, you know, and it still does, and his music lives on. But I was a big fan of his. Bobby was a big fan of his. So Bobby came down from Hibbing and stayed at my house. And I drove my father's 1958 Buick to the armory. Well, the wind chill factor in Duluth that night was -44 degrees. When we got to the armory, there was like 2,000 young people there. And we go in, and it was kind of a surreal scene. I mean, all these people were it was like a dance party. They were, it wasn't just Buddy Holly on the ticket on performing. There was a bunch of acts, and it was like a dance music agenda. And so I remember we come in to the armory entrance over here. I think we paid $2, which was a lot of money in 1959 for a ticket, you know. And that's what money would buy something.
Yeah.
And the stage was over here, and we had a, Bobby said, "I want to go right to the front." I said, "Okay." So I followed him and worked way through the crowd of young people, who many of them were dancing, the other were milling around talking, and we got right to the stage, the very front of the stage, nobody between us and the stage. And so when Buddy was performing, we were directly below him. And Bobby was mesmerized with him, and he studied him, and studied his music, he studied his postured actions and moves and everything, and he had a big influence on him. 3 days later, Buddy Holly, the Big Bopper, and Richie Valens all died in a plane crash after an Iowa concert.
Yeah. So that spot where he stood today is marked. They marked the spot that you described.
Yes.
And they're trying to restore the armory now.
Yes, yes. So they're doing a total restoration of the army. Armory was built in 1915. You know, it was the venue back in the day for any acts coming to Duluth. I was in Duluth 3 years ago doing a book event, and the people who are running this restoration heard I was coming to town. They contacted me. I went to the armory, and I showed them the exact spot where we stood, and they put a star there.
So that's the place that Bobby is described as having locked eyes with him.
Yes.
During the concert, and that he felt that there was some transmission of the gift.
Yes.
To him at that place.
Yes.
And it's just, I think about that, and it's right there. It's now been renamed Dylan Way.
Yes.
You showed me how to get there.
Yes.
Because I was looking for it when I was just the other week back up there in the North Country, and you can see it's right there on London Road.
Yes.
Dylan Way, his childhood home is just blocks away, and it's amazing to see that iconic place that he talks about in his Nobel Prize speech.
I might want to add, back in those days, they used to have open houses. You know, we were too young to go to bars. We were, you know, 15, 16, 17, 18 years old. So we would all congregate at somebody's house and hang out. And inevitably, there'd be a piano there. Mm-hmm. And whenever Bobby saw a piano, he was attracted to it. He would go right to it and start singing Jerry Lee Lewis style, who just passed away a few days ago, which was, you know, like pounding on the piano and like screaming. And inevitably, the parents would be in the house. They'd hear this. They'd come out. They'd see this, and we'd get kicked out.
Right.
We got kicked out of more open houses than I can remember. And I remember Bobby saying to me, you know, I'll show them one day. I'll be a rock and roll star.
Yeah, I actually met somebody who used to hear him in the some part of University of Minnesota, like in the lower stairwell or something. He would be playing the piano down there.
Yeah.
And he walked by. He says, "That's not music." You know, but he totally showed them that it is.
Yeah.
So one of the things I love, we went to see The Last Waltz together. You were wearing, you've worn your Star of David pretty much every day since.
Yeah, always, probably 45 years.
Yeah. And it was cool to see it like shining there on stage in the film. There's a part of your book that I would really love for you to read for us. And it's about the High Holidays. On Yom Kippur, at the end of Ne'ilah, the opening of the Ark, at the congregation in L.A., and I would love for you to read that excerpt, if you could.
It goes like this. It was Yom Kippur, the Jewish Day of Atonement at the tail end of the 1980s. Bobby was attending services at a Chabad house in Santa Monica. Presiding was the Venerable Rabbi Avram Levitansky, beloved and revered by his congregation. He had been there before, and the rabbi recognized Bobby right away. But few, if any, of his fellow worshipers, all somberly dressed, realized he was standing at the back of the room. Having, as usually, missed a memo regarding the dress code, Bobby was wearing cowboy boots, torn jeans, a hoodie, a black leather jacket, and what looked like a long-lost pair of Jackie Kennedy sunglasses. Specifically, he was attending the Ne'ilah service. In Hebrew, Nila means closing the gate. As the day of Yom Kippur comes to a close and our future is being sealed, we turn to God to offer our repentance and new resolutions and ask that he seal us in the book of life. We ask him to grant us a new year replete with goodness and happiness. The Nila ends with the blowing of the shofar and the prayer that includes, next year may we be in Jerusalem. The ark housing the holy scrolls of the Torah remains open for the entire service, and it's considered a great honor to be chosen by the rabbi to open it. This carries with it many blessings for the new year. The honor customarily goes to the temple's most generous donor, but not this time. With his ancient eyes, Rabbi Levitansky scoured the congregation. At last, his gaze came to rest upon a solitary figure standing in the back of the room. He motioned the casually dressed fellow up to the pulpit, and up he came. Bob Dylan opened the ark on Yom Kippur. Afterwards, when the last echo of the shofar had diminished to silence and most of the congregants had trickled away, the biggest donor to the temple sought out Rabbi Levitansky and pulled him aside. "I want you to know, Rabbi," said the man, "that when you didn't call me up to open the ark, I was quite hurt. Then I saw whom you chose, and I realized you were even wiser and kinder than I imagined. So I'm going to double my contribution for the coming year. It takes a great and generous heart to give the honor of opening the ark for Nila to a homeless Jew." The rabbi has long since passed away, taking his spiritual secrets with him. As for the donor, unless he reads it here, he still doesn't know that the homeless Jew was Bob Dylan.
Doesn't get any better than that. That's great. What beautiful stories your book has. Bob Dylan and Me, a wonderful, like so many more stories that I wanted to get to in our discussion. The Passover Seder.
With Marlon Brando.
Marlon Brando speaking Yiddish.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So many great stories that you have. And thank you for sharing your journey together with your dear friend. And it's an honor to be with you and to share this with the world. So I hope that we continue our conversation past this. I would love to give you as a gift The Philosophy of Modern Song that just came out by Bob Dylan.
Thank you.
And it's kind of a lot of explorations. Sounds very midrashic and very Talmudic. So I hope you enjoy more reading.
Thank you. I look forward to reading it.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Once upon a time, you dressed so fine, through the bumps of time in your prime.